Weiss+Associates presents Bernays, Propaganda, and the Federal Income Tax. Joseph Goebbels and the National Socialists of 1930s Germany were very well known for their elaborate propaganda campaigns, steered at convincing unsuspecting citizens that a cleansing was required to move Germany back into prosperous times following a depression. What's not well known is that those tactics utilized by the Nazis were actually invented by a few Americans, most notably Edward Bernays, but also influenced by the likes of Ivy Lee and Walter Lippmann. Bernays is actually regarded as the father of propaganda, and his strategies were used by corporations like the American Tobacco Company and the U.S. national government under Woodrow Wilson back in the 1910s. Bernays was born in Vienna, Austria, near where his uncle Sigmund Freud worked. Bernays' family moved to New York City when he was an infant, yet he continued to be fascinated by his uncle's work in the field of psychology. As a young adult, Bernays began to see how Freudian science could be used, not only in the field of mental health, but carefully integrated into the art of persuasion for use by both corporations and governments. This came at a time shortly after slavery's end, and large numbers of people were becoming educated. They no longer were driven by the use of overt force, but of course, they voted and they consumed, which drove the elite to use more sophisticated methods to keep control over the people. Bernays wrote a book called Propaganda that outlined his early experiences of integrating psychology into a manipulative script with the intent of the continuance of behavioral control of the masses. The first two paragraphs of the first chapter of this book is clear in spelling out the intent of propaganda. The conscious and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important element in democratic society. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism of society constitute an invisible government, which is the true ruling power of our country. We are governed, our minds molded, our tastes formed, our ideas suggested, largely by men we've never heard of. This is a logical result of the way in which our democratic society is organized. Vast numbers of human beings must cooperate in this manner if they are to live together as a smoothly functioning society. Walter Lippmann, another propagandist in the same era and a proud socialist, was far more blunt about his attitude toward the everyday American. He referred to the public as a bewildered herd who need to remain spectators and not participants in the important decision-making process. To him, the public was a bunch of ignorant and meddlesome outsiders, and it was simply best to keep them distracted by superficial consumerism. This idea was gobbled up by both the government and the corporate world, as they could benefit greatly. Not only are the unwashed masses distracted away from the important issues, but excessive consumerism could also drain them of whatever wealth they happened to accumulate thanks to the Industrial Revolution. These pitchmen experienced immediate success in casting their spell on the public. Bernays teamed with the American Tobacco Company, makers of the Lucky Strike cigarette, in an effort to make it stylish for women to smoke. In the late 20s, it was considered taboo for women to smoke in public, but Bernays went about an elaborate campaign to change all that. He hired attractive women to walk in an Easter parade in New York City while smoking cigarettes. This was crafted in conjunction with the women's liberation movement and was dubbed Torches of Freedom. When a study revealed that women didn't like the green packaging on Lucky Strikes, and the company deemed it too expensive to change the color, Bernays concocted a plan to instead make green the fashion color of the year. He held a green gala at the Waldorf Astoria and recruited the help of the press. Bernays and Lippmann worked together with the Woodrow Wilson administration in 1917, along with journalist George Creel, to form the Committee on Public Information in order to help shape public support for World War I. This included hiring over 100 artists who created thousands of designs for paintings, posters, and cartoons aimed at instilling patriotism, fear, and support for winning the war. It was an immensely successful venture, and needless to say, others took notice. The Bolsheviks tried similar tactics after the Russian Revolution around the same time, and Nazi Germany took propaganda to a whole other level during the turbulent 30s. Josef Goebbels was Hitler's minister of propaganda and was an ardent fan of Bernays' work. Goebbels was a struggling author and journalist, but took particular interest in the literary works of socialists Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. He latched on to the charismatic Adolf Hitler and found ways to integrate Bernays' strategies into his collectivist mindset. Of course, the Nazis were notorious liars, and propaganda got a bad name following the end of World War II in the 40s. But Bernays was still at the height of his profession in the U.S. Propaganda was rebranded as public relations, and the Department of War was changed to the Department of Defense. Perhaps his crowning achievement in mixing the worlds of corporate business with government control came in the 50s when he worked with the United Fruit Company. The company had a business cultivating bananas in Guatemala, and it came under threat of nationalization during a change of government. Bernays' efforts were backed by the famous Dulles brothers, Alan and John Foster, who were stakeholders in the company and also held high public offices within the U.S. government. With help from Bernays, articles were written and placed in prominent newspapers, and the democratic changes in Guatemalan government suddenly became a popular topic among these opinion molders. Later that decade, the CIA staged a coup d'etat to overthrow the current Guatemalan government and appoint a new president viewed more favorably by the Dulles brothers and the corporate elite. The corporate control over the Guatemalan banana industry was preserved. Currently, the United Fruit Company operates under the Chiquita brand. Today, we are still the target of strategies once practiced by these manipulators of information and molders of public opinion. Hillary Clinton used a similar term to bewildered herd in her expression that most Americans are made up in a subclass she referred to as deplorables. By these PR specialists, the public was viewed as useless eaters who are largely driven by their base instincts and carnal urges instead of careful consideration. Thus, in the view of the so-called intellectuals, it was the purpose of the elite to shape those opinions for the good of society and recover a lot of the money they handed out for manual labor. Bernays wrote, "Intelligent men must realize that propaganda is the modern instrument by which they can fight for productive ends and help to bring order out of chaos." Now, roughly a century after Bernays' work became noticed, how much has really changed? Are the unwashed masses still wrapped up in consumerism, or have they instead turned to critical thinking and questioning the narrative? In some ways, it's gotten better for the people, and in other ways, it's gotten worse. The brainwashing tactics have become more noticeable, and more people are finally waking up to the fact that they've been the target of an extensive psychological experiment. Although many millions have endeavored into the realm of a moral compass and reject the base urges that plague mankind, we are nonetheless under a bombardment of carefully crafted advertising and political messaging aimed at keeping the people as mere pawns in a game of global chess. Regarding the topic of income taxation, we can clearly see how similar messaging has been successful at convincing millions that a voluntary direct tax is obligatory, that all U.S. citizens are required to file a Form 1040, and that it's our patriotic duty to pay the federal income tax. This, of course, flies in the face of facts, the law, basic morality, and the clear vision of our founding fathers who knew the dangers of a direct tax and how it could be used to rob the everyday person of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In the minds of the elite, the less disposable income we have, the easier it is to organize their desired society and make even more money for themselves. Though Bernays had nothing to do with the creation of the federal income tax in 1913, the propaganda tactics popularized by him have helped create the image that the tax obliges everyone called U.S. citizens to file and pay every year. Unfortunately, millions believe that the federal income tax is obligatory, as similarly, many bought the hooey that cancer-causing cigarettes are somehow torches of freedom, or that endless wars are somehow means of protecting our liberties. When will the lies end? Well, never, if those disillusioned millions continue to be happy drinking the Kool-Aid given to them over and over. But there is hope on the horizon, and education is the foundation. Part of that education includes the realization that propaganda helps promote a false narrative. The false narrative is backed up by the mainstream media with expertly placed news articles and in the motion picture industry. Entertainment is a popular vehicle with which to get people to accept a multitude of ideas, some of which are correct, some of which aren't, but certainly nearly all of the messaging supports the elite's network of profit-taking and control. Celebrities are used as paid pitchmen, as when humans act as part of a herd, it becomes easier and cheaper to pay the celebrities millions of dollars to endorse a product, as opposed to paying much more money to convince the populace individually to try their product. Seeing yourself as an individual instead of a member of a group makes it much more difficult for their strategies to gain traction. When we as mindful humans stop giving elites and celebrities our energy and attention, this control mechanism quickly becomes powerless. The first step is seeing their playbook and how they're playing you. It's then that resistance to their tricks becomes easier.
Who would have believed it? You, an IRS agent? Death and taxes.
The revocation of election process can help remedy that. It's a method provided by the U.S. Congress to lawfully exit the U.S. tax club. This tax club was joined without any full disclosure of the ramifications, lack of willful knowledge regarding the deleterious long-term impact. This is a process in which we've helped thousands of people return to their born status of being a legal non-taxpayer of the federal income tax. There was no notice provided to any American national, those born in the Constitutional Republic, that such an election was a voluntary one, as none was provided within the Constitution or by the 16th Amendment. Weiss+Associates has a video outlining the facts and law regarding this topic. The link to the revocation of election video can be found in the show notes below. While viewing this important video, consider the facts presented and ask yourself whether you donated a large percentage of your hard-earned income every year to the government out of an actual requirement, or instead, out of a presumed custom created by these professional invisible wire pullers. We have an extensive library of educational videos, the links to which are located in the resource center of our website, weissparis.com. Questions and comments can be emailed to us at bilateral@gmx.com. Please smash the like button if you found this video informative and subscribe to our channel. Thanks for watching.